Good evening, my name is Michael Flechtner and I'm an artist who works in neon, and tonight we're going to bend up one of my three-dimensional airplanes. One of these airplanes is going to be there in the exhibit at the Pittsburgh Glass Center. So let's get started. So these are basically, you know, 90 degree bends in the crossfire. So we're going to take them one at a time. I'm bending lead glass, so that's why I'm not wearing my didymium glasses tonight. Here we go. But I do need these. Geez, if anything else catches on fire, let me know.
Will do.
All right, so here comes a little tricky part. it's just an obtuse angle, but I want to put a dihedral on my wings. I don't want them just completely flat, so I have a little spacer here. So when I come back to the pattern, once this bend is set, it will set the wing at a certain angle. So watch this. So we're just letting this cool down before I make the next bend. As you see, I have a specific spot where this, you know, half-inch piece of plywood goes, so that you know the angle's accurate for both sides. So a little rise I need to do right here. Now what I'm going to do in anticipation is I'm going to put this little rubber sleeve, and that kicks this up just a tiny little bit. And you'll see why I do that in a minute. This is just acting like a little prop. until I get this bend, until I get this bend taken care of. This little curve I do in the ribbon burner. The gas pressure just turned in the neighborhood. Somebody's sucking all the gas up there. This is just a 90 degree, and I sort of do this by eye, so I know where the angle is. I think I know where the angle is. So I'll just wait for this to cool down. So there is one half. I see where I'm going. Oh yeah, let me put up the pad. So now we're going to do the profile of this little airplane. Now the reason I put this little spacer on is when I go into fire and come back here and bend, this is always going to be tipped up a little bit, but I want this nice and flat on the pattern. So that's why you see this on here a lot of the time. You know, I'm wondering if that piece of glass I just used was soda glass. Yeah, because we're getting a lot of flare off of it. If it's leaded glass, you get flare. You usually get that dark lead look. I'm not seeing it. So this is flat to here, and then this is slightly elevated. And it's just to accommodate so that the whole thing will be, you know, nice and flat on the pattern. Thank you.
What's this block that you're using?
Which one?
This one?
Oh, just to flatten the bends down in case they have a little bit of a whoop in them.
Cool.
And you notice that I can throw the glass down. It seems like I throw the glass down. Mm-hmm. That's so if I'm too careful, or if anybody's too careful, trying to set glass down, sometimes you put an inadvertent bend in it. And so I just, when I get over to the pattern, I just basically drop it on the pattern. That eliminates that potential for getting an extra bend on it.
Would you say you drop it like it's hot?
Yeah, like a hot potato. So this is another simple 90, but I've set it up at a little angle. Matter of fact, stay out of trouble. Just waiting on it to cool down. So there's the profile of our airplane. All right, so it's a propeller plane, so now we have to make a propeller. I wonder if this is going to be soda or is it going to be lead? Out of the way. So I have a starting point, and then I go over to the set measurement that I have on the pattern that tells me how far I need to heat for the first bend. So now I have to do my 90 to get things out of the way. The propeller, of course, is basically an O, and we know how easy it is to bend up O's. Not at all. But so far, so good.
So far, so good.
Yeah, this is totally soda. Makes everything much more dramatic. This is my 90 degree reference block. All right, so we're about halfway around. Still pretty hot, so I don't want to grab it. And I need to make a couple reference marks. Rotate off the pattern, and then I'll take the measurement. So I'm using my blow hose as a measuring tool. It's So that's how much glass I need to heat to do that second bend. Still pretty hot. Always give a double check. Make sure you don't get yourself into big trouble. So basically, I'm just reminding myself which of these marks I have to line up with. So in order to close this up, I have to get this out of the way. So we'll just wait a few moments for that to set up. So I'm just measuring where I need to heat. And when you're doing these ribbon burner bends, you have to go back into the original bend just a little bit so you can get them to... The ideal is to make sure that they are smooth, there's a smooth transition. So that's what I'm going for. So, wish me luck. Now we're probably wondering, oh, how are you going to get that around there? These are my helpers. So I just basically just made that bend go around the corner about 90 degrees. I do another 90 here. So see, sometimes, you know, bending up part of a neon unit, you have to use kind of like indirect techniques to get where you want to go. Talk to my little friends again. Just one more little adjustment. There's our propeller. So we're ready to move on to the next stage, to the assembly stage, Tina.
Sweet.
All right, so we're shooting.
Mm-hmm.
So we have all our parts now. We have this wing and this wing. We have our profile. And we have our propeller. So those are the basic components of my airplane. So we have to fuse some things together. This actually goes fairly quickly. Searches for his glasses. I can't see my glasses without my glasses. Now you probably remember these two little pieces of wood from earlier. Oh, I never remember the best way to go. Gotta lean this down just a little bit. try not to set you on fire. Sorry.
Much appreciated.
So we're just waiting for the well to cool down. Probably there. I usually write no throw on these things. Lest I forget what I'm up to. Any magic you see is purely unintentional.
I don't believe it.
Oh, wait.
There it is.
Whoa, cools down. So you see this thing slowly coming together. Now for the propeller. Thank you. that to make sure I'm not running, gonna run into any unexpected issue. Get in there. Now I'm just aligning the propeller so it doesn't look cattywampus or whopper jaw. I'm going to weld on a set of electrodes. High-tech cork.
Is that a pipe cleaner?
Yes. Gotta be careful not to have my elbow on the rose one. Let's get this out of the way. Still a tiny hole. All right, so. other electrode. There's the assembled plane. So here we are. This is basically the manifold, the bombarder manifold. And we have three gases on here, neon gas, argon gas, and krypton gas. And what we have to do is we have to bombard this airplane, which means we have to heat sterilize it under vacuum in order to get the interior of the tubing perfectly clean, very hygienic, and then we'll backfill under vacuum, the backfill with neon gas in this case, so we'll have a red-orange airplane. So let's get started. So first thing I have to do is attach the airplane to the manifold. Tisa, you'll notice that I haven't thrown this hand torch on the ground and set the carpet on fire.
Safety first.
So we've got that thing. And look, remember that thing we did the other day? Uh-huh. All right, so now the airplane's fused to the manifold. So we have some business to take care of. We have to hook up the electrical connections. Now the transformer that we use to heat this up internally puts out 18,000 volts at half an amp, so we have to be very careful with it so that nobody gets electrocuted. Alright, so we have our electrical connections. Because high vacuum and high voltage don't mix, I have to put mica in certain spots in the airplane where the tubes come very close together. And this prevents the electricity from jumping through the glass. And if it jumps through the glass, it leaves a tiny exit hole and a tiny entrance hole, and you have to start all over again. And we don't want to start over again tonight. So mica goes in the strategic spots. All right, so we have the mica in. We have to know what temperature the neon tube is getting, so we have a thermometer that we can connect to read the temperature directly. And I also have an infrared thermometer. This is a non-contact thermometer. This also tells us how hot things are getting. I use them both just to kind of make sure everything's accounted for. All right, so I think this is ready to go. I'm switching on the bombarder, and first thing you have to do is get enough vacuum in the tube to get it so it'll light. So we're taking air out of it, essentially. So I'll open up this valve and start tapping on the bombarder. All right, so as soon as it lights, I close the vacuum. So look at all the schmutz.
Did you dump water inside that?
Yeah. What? So, got the glass up at about 266 degrees centigrade, so it's a little bit over Fahrenheit 451. Yeah, we have a hole in it.
Oh no. What? You found it?
Yeah.
That was quick.
I'm glad it's where it's at. I thought it was right there, but there's a tiny little hole right there, so we just have to do a quick repair.
Best case scenario.
Yeah, best case scenario. Now, this is still real hot, so I can't grab it. Unless you want me to grab it.
Mm-mm.
Tubulation just exploded.
Oh. I do that sometimes.
I know. Who would have thought the glass was so temperamental?
Everybody.
Ow. All right, so. Just have to repeat that process. Ideal temperature is 226 degrees centigrade, which is right around Fahrenheit 451. And again, this is just air in there. So we want to get the glass hot first, and then we want to get the electrode shells glowing. That will tell us that we activated the emitter coating that's inside of them. All right, so we got the glass hot enough. We got the electrode shells glowing. So this has been bombarded. And what we're watching for is for the vacuum to go down. And when it gets down to around 10 or 5 microns, the glass will cool down enough, and then we'll backfill with neon gas. So right now we're just waiting for the vacuum to continue downwards and wait for the glass to cool down a little bit. And this is the test coil. This is basically a Tesla coil, so it puts out about 10,000 volts. We use this basically to find leaks. That's how we found that leak. And it also gives you an idea of the relative vacuum inside of the tube. So, great tool. They've been making these things for over 100 years. So, if you ever need a little jolt, it's the way to go. Wow, it's still on.
Mm-hmm.
Did I chase it?
No.
Good thing you're here. Yeah, not in the easiest place. What I had to do there is where I'm going to pull the tubulation, that tiny little 5mm glass off the electrode. That doesn't get hot during the bombarding process, but it still retains moisture. And so we get in there with a hand torch to drive that moisture off. That moisture is being sucked into the manifold, down into the vacuum pump, and eliminated into the atmosphere. Actually, it doesn't go into the atmosphere. It goes into the oil in the vacuum pump, and then we get rid of it by changing the pump oil. So things are moving along pretty smoothly. I'm going to give it a quick bump. See, nothing lights because there's almost nothing in that tube anymore. So that's a good sign. And it didn't arc through there, even though I removed the mica. So what we can do now is we're going to fill it. So I know this is probably about 6 feet of glass. It's 8 millimeters. And so it's going to require, Tisa, you probably know this, probably going to require about 24 millimeters of gas pressure. So close the manometer. I protect the gauge tube. Make sure this is open. I close the main vacuum, and now I'm backfilling with neon gas. There's 15, I can't let it go all the way up, or I blow up the gauge, and so now we give it a quick bump. Now we can pull it off the manifold. But be on the safe side, switch.
Mm-hmm.
Safety. All right, so it's chock full of neon gas, but the gas is there, but it's below atmospheric pressure. So instead of this creating a bubble, it will suck in and then seal itself off, which it's done. Now the plane itself is still relatively hot. So when I first put it on the aging in transformer, it might be a little off color. Ow! The whole plane is still red hot.
Oh no.
Can't believe you let me touch it. Alright, so this is the part of the process called aging in. Aging in. And so you just basically connect it to a fairly high voltage transformer. In this case, it's a 12,000 volt transformer. And you just switch it on and let it run for a little while. Now, like I said, the tube is pretty hot, and so we're going to remove this color in there. But the aging in process means you just let it run until the gas comes in consistent throughout the whole piece and is also the right color. So we're going for the bright red orange, and that's what we're getting. Like I said, if we would have waited for it to get down to room temperature when we first switched it on, oh, look at that. When we first switched it on, it would just be, you know, that really consistent red color. So basically, all we have to do now is pull off that little extension and, you know, let the plane continue to age in, and then, you know, later on I'll put it on the mounting, and then it's going to end up at the Pittsburgh Glass Center. So again, because it's under vacuum, it collapses, seals off, and you get rid of that. So now, the part that could break off pretty easily is removed.
That's awesome.
Now we can finish aging this thing in. It looks like it's going to fly away.
It does.
All right, so I think we've done it. Thank you so much.